So this will be a sort of fun talk, which is not related really to any of our work and nothing done for profit. So I'm normally team lead of the toolchain team. As such, I'm also a compiler developer, mostly working on GCC. And because that's not enough, I'm in my free time working on a different compiler, which is TinyCC. I basically noticed the existence of it 4 years ago, and since then hacking on it on and off. So quick overview of it. It started was started by Fabrice Bralat, which may be known as the initial author of QEMU to some people in 2001 as an international obfuscated C code contest entry, which was so it was a subset, it was a compiler for a subset of C, which was able to compile itself, and the whole source code was like, I think, 1023 bytes. So it was emitting 386 code. It was really obfuscated. If you want to Google, then you find the code. It's really not easy to understand. A little bit later, it was deobfuscated and made basically a proper project. Term TinyCC, which is easy to do because if you start with a 1K byte source code, then you can only do so much to enlarge it. So it's still small. Contains a preprocessor, a compiler, an assembler, a librarian, and a linker in one executable. So it's basically the whole interesting toolchain except the C library is inside one executable. Supports four architectures. It once supported two others that are bit rotted meanwhile, bare metal Linux and Windows targets. So it actually has code to emit ELF binaries and Windows PECOF binaries and just binary images, blobs. It can also compile into memory, so the target doesn't have to be an executable file, but it can be directly run. And it's as a support, it roughly supports C99 standard, plus some GNU extensions, and a little bit of C11, basically, whenever somebody feels an itch, he scratches it and implements some support. It's a single-pass compiler, so there's no optimization in it. Except those that fit into the single passness. So it actually, during tokenizing and parsing, it also emits the code. So, well, there are some issues with that. It has to have a jump table and the like, but essentially it's a single pass compiler, so, which is why it's also very quick. Just some code line stats, so it's 22k lines of code for the common code and 5k for the x86 64 target, and the executable, depending on how it's compiled, it's around 250k for everything. As I said, that's the assembler and compiler and linker, everything in one executable. With GCC, it's smaller because TCC tends to generate larger code. It doesn't inline functions, it can't optimize much of that code away. It has to generate larger sequences of instructions just because potentially they might be reached by out-of-range labels. So it can't emit the same small and dense code like GCC can do. Actually, a couple years ago, I worked on an optimizer for that, and this was actually I had a better code quality than with GCC 0.0, but still a single pass compiler and still faster. Just to give a short demo of what TCC is basically about, I have this is too small, I know. Is that readable? So let's see. Very clean. This is GNU AWK, AWK. Time make. So compiling with GCC without optimization, just J1 needs like 3 seconds. And with, I hope that all works. With TCC, it's like it's faster. Five times as fast. I have another. In the year 2005, Fabrice Berlard was still working on TinyCC, and he thought, "Oh, it would be a nice demonstration of its capabilities if it would be able to compile the Linux kernel from that time." It was like a 2.4 range, and he created a project, TCC Boot, he called it, which basically used the facility to compile into memory and not into into an executable file. And basically, during boot, it started the compiler and compiled the source code into memory and then called that as the kernel, right? So, and this is not exactly what I'm demonstrating. I will just demonstrate that it's also compiling is into an executable file or into a file. What did I want to write? So, which is it's a hacked up compilation script. It's not using the normal kernel build systems. I hope that's okay. So, what is it? So this is basically the compilation step. So roughly 2 seconds on this machine. For compiling a 2.4 kernel, which is actually capable of booting. I don't have it here. Why not? Ah, yeah, it was a different shell. So this is basically booting a small 2.4 kernel with a network and everything. So in 2 seconds. Okay. So it actually does work. and then given this, I thought, well, maybe let's apply that to the current Linux kernels because I don't have enough to do and games were running out. So let's try to waste some time on TCC and modern Linux kernels. That's basically where I came from 2 years ago. And since then, I was basically whenever I felt like it, hacking on TCC to make that possible. The stats of what I just showed of that kernel, it's really a very minimal configuration, but with network, it contains about 7 million lines of code and 200 megabytes of source text to parse. I should say, if I'm saying 200 megabytes of source text to parse, I really mean every single byte that is read in by the compiler. So if there are two files that include the same header file, then this header file is counted twice. Right, so it's really every single byte that is read in with the syscall to open files and read in and textually parsed is about 200 megabytes. 2 to 3 seconds to build on this machine. Doing the same on x86-64 Linux, 4.6 is like, what was it, 2005? So it's 13 years, well, let's say 10 years of development since TCC boot. And maybe I can just go to the stats of the configuration that I, in the end, chose to use. It's not 200 megabytes of sources, it's 2 gigabytes of sources to parse. What the hell? It's 66 million lines of code. It also contains network, but not much else. It's the smallest sensible configuration I basically found. And the VM Linux file is like 20 megabytes. It's also 10 times of the Linux 2.4 one. I don't know what you are doing as kernel developers, but you are very, very Productive, yes, productive, yes. Right, you can say it that way, yes. So, okay. So, and due to that productivity, you also chose to use many interesting features that the compiler guys unfortunately provided to you. So it was all working fine 15 years ago. Nevertheless, you don't stop to introduce new features. So what I basically had to do over the years, I started in 2016 in a hack week. I had to implement new assembler instructions for x86-64, obviously. There are some operands were not working correctly. Then some assembler directives like fill, push, pop section, set directives, and so on that you are using not only in the inline assembler but also there. PC relative expressions, compare expressions. So you make meanwhile quite some uses of GNU assembler features that Boris is always asking me about, and then I'll find something for him, and then he uses it, and I should stop answering your mails, and then it ends up in mainline, yeah? Which is one reason why I stayed with 4.6. I didn't want to develop against a moving target. So very many assembler glitches and fixes I had to do then in the compiler itself. Meanwhile, the build systems are using several features. I listed all of them. Oh, many of them I just... two hours ago, I basically was browsing the Git repository for things I had to do, and these are basically some of them. Maybe what's interesting, struct layouts was not completely compatible with GCC, which is important if the layout of the interrupt descriptor table entries is wrong, then nothing works during startup. So that was a bitch to find out. One thing maybe interesting is GCC compiles its C source code into assembler source code, and then it gives it off to the assembler, and then that one does its thing. Which means that if you from inline assembler, which is pasted verbatim into the output assembler file, referenced some symbols from that are defined in the C parts in the same file, then this all happens automatically because the references from the C part end in the assembler file, the verbatim snippets of the inline assembler end in the assembler file, and the assembler will see the same name from both parts. It doesn't actually know that one part came from C and one part came from inline assembler, and it just happens to work. TCC contains an integrated assembler, so the symbol tables need to be basically the same to make that work. I compiled many projects with TinyCC without that feature, so but not the Linux kernel. Computed includes local register variables, strange things. One particular caveat is the kernel uses on x86-64 the negative space, which is negative address space. If you know the details about x86-64 addressing, then you will know what I mean. But in the end, it means that all the program counter addresses on x86-64 in the kernel space are looking like negative numbers, which means that references, PC relative references, so offsets between such kind of addresses only function correctly if they are signed. What time do I have? So then, more things. So that is just to pass things. Then there are the things where the kernel very much likes to use basically conditional compilation without it actually using the preprocessor to conditional compile. It basically has code like if some complicated expression call a function, which and that function is not being linked into the final binary if that condition is basically known false. TCC is not an optimizing compiler, so it just was emitting, basically, if false, then call this function and fine. So not linked. So I had to implement a small optimizer that is at least when the conditions are trivially false, that then any code that is basically guarded by such a condition is simply not emitted without breaking the one-passedness of TinyCC, which means it doesn't work in all cases, but actually it works in surprising many cases because the kernel guys are not that crazy with their obviousness of conditions. One caveat is that sometimes these conditions are actually calls to inline functions, which are basically defined as return zero. As TCC doesn't inline anything, that's one of the conditions that it can't prove always false, and that breaks down then. So I had to modify the kernel sources to, at least for these cases, make a preprocessor define for that function, which is defined to zero and not an inline function, right? similarly, conditions that start with a zero and logical end, foobar, that references to foobar, are not emitted. I certainly wanted to write something here, but I forgot. That inline functions are unemitted from that code. And so basically, functions that are declared inline and called in such dead sections should not be emitted, because they themselves could then, again, contain references to such kind of functions that are not actually linked into the final VM Linux binary. I'm interested in working on compilers, not so much in build systems and the like. So I had to cheat for a little bit. For instance, the TCC, for obvious reason, doesn't support the full syntax of GNU linker scripts, which is made heavy use of in linking the Linux kernel. So for the time being, I'm using just GNULD for linking it. There are some things still missing, especially the macro support for the assembly files, which basically prevents me from compiling many of the assembler files within the Linux kernel. So I use GNU assembler for those, and to not complicate my life, I implemented all nice assembler extensions into TCC, but now I'm not using it because I compile just all assembler files with GNU assembler. So there will be next tech weeks. Eventually I will get there. I can't emit 16-bit code from within TinyCC, just not implemented, which means that the whole 16-bit startup code and the real mode Trempo lines must also use GCC at the time. So if that is all implemented, then I was at a state of basically this. Let's see. So with a basically hacked up some changes to the Linux kernel itself, and then with the TCC inner state, I just demonstrated or told you about. So let's compile with this kind of TCC VM Linux with a sort of reasonable configuration. Oh, that's faster. Okay, 9 seconds. So 9 seconds wait, that's something that's... no, that's the very small configuration, sorry. that's my sheeting. That should come afterwards. I think. Oh, let's clean again. Okay, so let's build again with a slightly larger configuration. It's nice, it's quick, it's okay, but it's not quite managing to give the promise of what the talk is titled like. So it's 21 seconds, give or take, with J4, so on this laptop. No, it doesn't. It doesn't give seconds. A little bit, perhaps. Yeah, but it will. I'm just doing, you know. Okay, that's 2 seconds or something that gets it off. Yeah, that's right. So roughly 19 seconds is the kind of compilation by force, basically. I will not demonstrate running it now because I'm running out of time. Compilation works. Ah, right. And if then now I have a VM Linux. I don't yet have a bootable kernel. So then I make the rest as well. So a BZ image. And that takes another, because there was a something else running in before. It takes about 6 seconds to just build from a finished BZ image, from a finished VM Linux, the compressed bootable BZ image. About 6 seconds, and I wouldn't be able to parallelize that or even optimize that in any way, because that's not, the time is taken by gzip and not by TinyCC. So we have this. The stat is about demo of that. Yeah, that was the demo. So 200 million, 60 million lines of code on 2 gigabyte sources. So the result is about 19 seconds for VM Linux, 6 seconds for BZ image. There's basically no way I can get this with under 2 seconds with J1. I realized at that time. But maybe we can still do something. And if we do look at perf, then from behind you won't see that, but it's next no macro, token string at macro substitution, next is getting the next token, macro substitution, pre-processing, next no macro, pass comment, next no macro space. It's all the preprocessor and tokenizer. Basically, this is actually how it should be in a proper compiler. The most part should be taken by tokenizing. And so in this sense, TCC is a proper compiler. GCC is not. So all the tokenizer and preprocessors. So, and that's about when I started basically trying to speed up TCC in several ways. So first, let's get rid of busy image because I can't really speed that up. So initially, I tried to just make it the BZ image, make it not compressed, so that would me get rid of the gzip time, but that still wasn't what I wanted in the end, and was actually complicated for not much gain. Really, much nicer it would be if I could directly boot the VM Linux image, right? So, and QAMO has the facility to start multi-boot images from basically arbitrary files, which is what I then implemented. So my VM Linux is a multi-boot image that, with one small hack for your QEMUs, can be loaded directly with it without going the busy image route, which also means that I don't need the 16-bit startup code because QEMU already switches into 32-bit mode. And the other thing is TCC can compile multiple files in one step into one single object file, which means I don't need to pay the multiple startups and stops of the 400, or in this case, I think it's 800 processes, TCC processes, writing individual object files and then linking all of them together. I can just basically, in this case, I split it because I have a four CPU machine. I split the whole file list basically into four parts and compile them in parallel into four individual object files. The parts link with GNU-LD into the final VM Linux and be done with it. So basically, I had scripts to build VM, or have scripts to build VM Linux in just a few steps. These look like, let's continue. Then I rewrote the preprocessor, optimized it. Compiling multiple files in one step already brings us down from 19 to 12 seconds. So that's actually the largest part. Then rewriting the preprocessor brings us down to 9 seconds, always with four parts, so four times parallel. Then the last thing I did in the last hack week was optimizing the tokenizer in not tokenizing anymore. So whatever already was tokenized, because as I said, the 2 GB source code actually consists of the same header files 800 times, roughly, let's say 400 times, because many C files include the same headers again and again. So if we tokenize them already, we can just store the result of that and directly access just integer arrays, which is indeed brings us down to 6 seconds from 19. So, and I think, let's see. Yeah, 3 minutes, that's enough because it's very quick in compilation. This is the result from a normal hacked make system, and this is the result. Commands 2. So this commands 2 is basically my hack script that calls TCC in the right way and the linker and everything. And let's see. So this is just the multi-step mode without any optimization in the preprocessor. And I hope it actually, it takes quite long. 12 seconds to compile everything, and then a little bit more for the pre-processing of what needs to be compiled by GCC. As I said, some parts need GCC and GNU Assembler, plus the final linking. That's the free time linking because of the all symbols inclusion. So 12 seconds with that, and and just with a new preprocessor, it's like, oh, 9 seconds, still basically the same result. And with the pre-compiled headers, or better actually, it's more like pre-tokenized headers that are just held internally in memory. Even though it needs a command line switch that looks like if it's using a directory, but it's not. So 7 seconds with all that optimization. I can prove that this is actually, so this is my hacked QEMU. That it has the newer versions of QEMU have sanity checks for multi-boot images that make no sense, even though they are documented as basically sane constraints on the incoming data, but they are just bollocks. But QEMU implements checks for them, and so that's just removed. And if you see here the kernel VM Linux, that's really the normal. Normal executable, which contains the Linux kernels. So Yay, yeah. So, no job control, as I said, it's a relatively minimal thingy, and toll. So, what do I have? Wow, some programs, email stress. Okay, yeah, it's some old init RD of mine. So the result indeed works. And so, which brings me to the last slide. 6 seconds is not quite what I wanted to achieve, so a little more cheating is involved, a really, really small configuration. And now, nah. It needs a different script because the file list is different and it's hard-coded. So, and with this really minimal configuration, which means no network in particular, it only takes 2.8 seconds on this machine in 4 times parallel. On my home machine with 8 threads, it's 1.3 seconds, which means I think the give or take of 1 second compilation of a kernel is achieved. So, questions?
If you disable the output.
Which output? Yeah, no. I mean, I it's a local machine. That is not. It's not really.
Yeah.
2.5. So it's not really. Good. Then we are 2 minutes over, and I guess the next talk is on.